Brazilian underworld through fear. Hooded assassins, armed with sophisticated weapons and specialist skills. Over 270 species of these elite snakes belong to the Elapidae family. Their reign of terror spans two continents, where their name alone evokes widespread panic. For included in their ranks are the world's greatest venomous snakes. They are the Cobra Mafia. A newly hatched forest cobra draws her first breath and rests for a moment. A creature sometimes revered, but mostly feared. Born fully independent, instinct is already driving her. A powerful array of finely tuned senses is firing up. Her mission is to survive. And to survive, she must kill. She's on her own, and dangers abound. She may be the only one of 13 siblings to survive. But she's a natural-born killer. Equipped with an inherited arsenal of deadly weapons and characteristic cobra bad attitude. Her presence stirs fear as her family name and reputation precedes her. For good reason. Petal might be at her most vulnerable right now, but she's a little hunter in the making. And will soon see just what she's capable of. For she belongs to a veteran gang of predators who rule the reptilian streets of Africa and Asia. The Cobra Mafia is a group of ruthless hitmen, each equipped with a set of skills to run their operations. Unlike most other groups of snake species, they're armed with hollow fangs designed like hypodermic needles, used to inject deadly venom into their victims. But it's their trademark move and iconic shape that distinguishes them from most other serpents. Raising a third of their body length off the ground, they use specially adapted muscles to expand modified ribs. And stretching their neck skin, they form hoods, striking the defense pose that has terrified their enemies for centuries. But there are imposters within their ranks. Cousins who have mastered the move, even employ the hooding. And their behavior behind closed doors doesn't comply with the strict Cobra code of conduct. Is this a family of cold-blooded killers, or have they just earned a bad reputation? Africa's hot jungles are home to high-ranking mob members, the forest cobras. Meet Romeo, Don of Africa's forests and waterways, one of the biggest, meanest badasses around. His species' territory stretches throughout the African rainforests, making him one of the largest true cobras with such impressive real estate in the world. And big guys play with big guns. Romeo's bringing his to the heat of this battle. But When it comes to the ladies, he means business. But the prize he's fighting for might not hang around long enough to be won. Fern is a female forest cobra. She's hanging back in the shadows, interested enough, but not convinced of either male's prowess. Yet. They'll have to prove their mettle to win her admiration, and possibly a chance to mate with her. Is either guy cobra enough to convince her he's the one? In Asia, Fern's cousin, the King Cobra, is also working the dating department. And she set her sights pretty high. She's after the Godfather. As far as potential mates go, he'd be the catch of the century. He's got the whole package. His species title as king comes with a vast territory that spans the forested regions in India across into Southeast Asia, an area almost the size of North America. Growing to over 17 feet in length, he's the world's longest venomous snake. Elongated muscles and tendons stabilize his ribs and lower body, allowing him to extend upwards. When he pulls this classic cobra-style move, he can look a grown man of 6 feet in the eye. And he packs a mighty punch, too. With venom glands that stretch from just behind his eyes, King Cobras can inject up to 600 milligrams of venom in one bite. Only 20 milligrams of venom is lethal to a human. So with one bite, the king can inject enough venom to kill 20 people or a fully grown Asian elephant within 3 hours. With all that adding to his appeal, he's got his hands full with the ladies. While snakes grow throughout their lives, their skins don't grow with them. Every few months they will shed, like the female has just done. Her newly sloughed skin leaves a pheromone trail as she steers a path ahead of him. Cast aside like a dusty old coat, it acts as a beacon to catch the king's eye. If he picks up what she's putting down, he might decide to follow his nose or tongue. Because for snakes, smelling is more a matter of taste. As the Godfather flicks his tongue, he collects particles from the air and transfers them to the Jacobson's organ in the roof of his mouth for analysis. Like a photograph being developed, this information creates a mental image of what he's tasting. With his forked tongue, he tastes in stereo, and he's picked up on her trail. But the female is cautious and keeps just ahead of him. Letting him get too close could be dangerous. King Cobra males are known to be aggressive. If he tries to catch up to her with bad intentions, she needs a quick escape route, or things could turn ugly, like it did for this female King Cobra. In a classic case of fatal attraction, The female's got her king's attention. But is he in the mood? Or is she dicing with death? The king cobra has caught sight of the female up ahead. He edges closer to take a better look. But as he stops and raises his body, she seems uncertain about his intentions. Cobras typically strike their classic pose when they feel intimidated. By looking bigger, they can frighten away a potential threat. But he may just be tuning into one of his more unique and little understood senses. What we think of as hearing, for him, is better described as feeling. Snakes have no external ears and no eardrums like we do. Instead, the Godfather feels vibrations caused by movement in the air and along the ground. One way these vibrations can be transmitted is through the body, to the tissue surrounding the jawbone into the auditory system. Here, the auditory system within the inner ear relays the signal to the brain. The Godfather seen or heard something that sends him in the opposite direction. The female's been rejected, but at least she's alive to tell the tale. While her Asian cousin deals with rejection, African forest cobra Fern is getting impatient as the male's posture, pose, and tangle themselves up again. But things are looking up. Romeo is pulling out the big guns. Physical conflict comes with a great risk of injury, and even minor ones like a bite in the wild can be fatal. But Romeo's got a secret weapon. His tail's very last scale is shaped into a hard, pin-sharp spike. Like a switchblade, he whips it out when things really kick off. Just a little jab could trick his enemy into believing he's been bitten. The final stab means Fern is his. If it's not too late. She's given up waiting for the brawlers, heading off instead in search of lunch. Romeo will have to track her into the forest. There's a reason forest cobras have chosen to work the waterways and forests of Africa. Frogs, toads, and even fish form a large part of a forest cobra's diet. And she needs to be an excellent swimmer to get around. Undulating and thrusting forward, she inflates her lungs, keeping her body afloat as she navigates the pools and streams in search of food. A toad sees her coming. Leaping away, he dead-ends any tasty trail she might pick up. But Fern doesn't rely only on smell or taste when hunting. Binocular vision enables her to pick up visual cues as subtle as the toad's breathing. Toad can smell her. He can't tell which way she's coming from. Like a missile launcher, she's locked onto her target, calculating exact coordinates for her strike. Frugal with her valuable ammunition, Fern injects just enough neurotoxic venom required to kill him. He puffs himself up, a classic Toad defense move, making himself bigger. But it's the last move he'll ever make. Fern will swallow the Toad slowly, stretching her jaw to accommodate his size and digest him at leisure. This may give Romeo a much-needed opportunity to catch up to her. While Fern's perfected her forest hunting skills, her cousin, Capo, a Cape Cobra, lives in a slightly different neighborhood. It's a beat Fern couldn't survive in. Scorching heat, little shelter, and unusual prey options means Capo's had to develop a special set of skills and a totally different modus operandi to remain Don of the desert. His stronghold stretches across the arid southwestern region of Africa, one of the harshest environments on Earth. The vast dry expanses of uninhabited wilderness shape the behavior patterns of all the creatures that have adapted to live here. But Capo and his crew of day hunters are tough. They'll do anything to survive. There's very little food to be found here, so Capo isn't picky. He'll eat whatever he can catch, or even scavenge on carrion. But that means he's sometimes on the menu too. If there's one place in a desert that should be safe from predators, it's up, as high as possible. Sociable weavers build great grassy apartment blocks, specially designed to keep enemies out. Access is only possible by air from below. But Capo's got a trick to get in. This is a hit he's got to make. With so little food around, a chance at a prize this rich is too good to pass up. As he picks his way up the tree, up to 100 pairs of weaver eyes could spot Capo and sound the alarm to mob him. But he's timed his operation well. The birds are caught up in their daily activities, and his scales provide perfect camouflage. There's no stopping his stealthy approach now. He can taste lunch on the air. Elongated muscles holding together hundreds of vertebrae means Capo is like one long elastic band, able to twist around any angle. For Capo, it's like raiding a well-stocked store. A nest like this is a valuable food resource for him. At any given time, it may be home to over 200 chicks, and he needs only two or three to fill him up. Breaching the security of a weaver's nest is a tough job, but Capo's pulling it off. Mafia's success bodes well for the breeding season ahead. Like Romeo and the Godfather, he'll soon be looking for a mate. Finding one out here can use up a whole lot of energy. Fern hasn't moved far from where she caught her lunch. It's given Romeo a chance to catch up to her. Making eye contact, they seem to like what they see. But visual stimulus is all Romeo's got to go on at the moment. Even though Fern's giving off signals that she's ready to mate, he'll have to put her to the taste test just to make sure they're on the same wavelength. Snake's sex pheromone molecules are too large to float through the air. To know where he stands with her, he'll have to touch his tongue to her body. The pheromones he tastes will give him valuable information like her age and if she's ready to mate. Turns out, she's not just a tease. To seduce her, Romeo gently nudges her body with his head, rubbing against her, rippling his muscles as he lies beside her. When she's all loved up, she'll lift the base of her tail and he'll entwine his with hers. But the couple briefly splits apart. Their activities could last all day. The tree stump boudoir offers them a little privacy and protection while their attention is elsewhere. Only newly hatched snakelings, hours old, are more vulnerable to an enemy attack than they are now. Romeo and Fern are lucky in love, but what they don't know is that their cozy beat is about to be invaded. But not by an enemy. This is an inside job. Two young newcomers are searching for fresh hunting grounds. The cousins of the forest cobras. Armed with unique firepower, they're headed straight for Romeo and Fern's territory in the forest. It's early spring, and some important decisions to make. Although she's just mated with Romeo, she isn't pregnant yet. Like many female snakes, she's got her own natural form of birth control, allowing her to store sperm and impregnate herself later. She's waiting for just the right time and place to lay her eggs. They'll need up to 80 days to hatch, so she needs to hurry. The longer she delays, the later in summer her babies will be born. They'll need the abundant food and warm weather of the season to get a good start in life. The added pressure of competition for food they could face during colder months may cause Fern to abandon her baby plans for the year. She can store Romeo's sperm for months, even years. Yet the longer she leaves it, the higher the chance of it deteriorating. Worse still, something could happen to her before she gets another chance to have her young. With summer on its way and the unwelcome arrival of her cousins imminent, she's up against a fast approaching deadline. Meet Fern's cousins. Hailing from the high-altitude rocky outcrops and grasslands north of her territory, the Rinkhals, otherwise known as the Faker, seldom ventures too far south. So what's the real reason he's fleeing his usual beat? Closing in from the east, his accomplice, the sniper, is also heading south towards the forest. He's looking for fresh hunting grounds. His real name is a dead giveaway for the highly specialized, unique weapons he and his cousin, the Wrinkles, are carrying. He's a Mozambique spitting cobra. Together, they're coming armed to the teeth. Literally. Like their cobra relatives, these two have needle-like fangs. But they've got an extra adaptation for more serious firepower. The central ducts are like the trajectory of a high-powered rifle, but customized with an exit point at the front of the fang, rather than at the tip like their non-spitting relatives. This means that when they force venom at high speed down the barrel of their fangs, it shoots straight out in whatever direction they're aiming, spraying their targets with a toxic shower up to 10 feet away. It's the perfect defense weapon. No contact is required, and venom in the eyes of their victims can quickly cause blindness. Wrinkles are distinguished by the white bands on their necks when they hood, but they're masters of disguise. Their dorsal scales vary in color from dirty gray to bright yellow and red stripes, making them hard to identify. But that's not the only trick the Wrinkles have up their sleeves. An old rival has recently taken up residence in the rocky outcrops the Wrinkles and his crew usually patrol. He's got a reputation as a snake killer. Weighing up to 35 pounds, rock monitors snack on snakes like the Wrinkles. But the lizard is about to be scammed. If Wrinkles can't spit their way out of trouble, they play dead. So well, it's an act worthy of an Oscar. But it's not just death they're good at faking. Their keeled rough scales, so unlike shiny smooth cobra skin, betray these tricksters' true identities. They're merely distant relatives who've adopted cobra characteristics. But they're proving themselves worthy honorary members of the cobra family. Leaving his territory, the Wrinkles must pass through human settlements along the way. He and his crew are often found hanging about homes and construction sites. But it's not because they like people. The Wrinkles runs a successful pest control operation, and he's got a reputation for taking no prisoners. Rodents spread disease and cause destruction. A single female mouse can have up to 140 babies a year. Left unchecked, rodents could take over the world. He's usually not seen or heard, but he's polite and pulls his weight around the house. In lieu of rent, he rids homes of other unwanted guests. The briefest contact is enough for him to inflict a deadly bite. Neurotoxins flood her bloodstream, quickly disarming her nervous system killing her within minutes. A fully grown ringcalls may feed only once every few weeks. But he's not full yet. There's always room for dessert. His tastes may seem unpleasant, and his presence strikes fear. But the ringcalls has nothing on his Asian co-conspirator. A snake who's also adopted the Cobra name, and whose status as king serves as a convenient cover for his diabolical habits and tastes. With his Cobra good looks and similar anatomical features, the Godfather has also managed to pass himself off as one of them. But a slight twist in the menu when it comes to dinner time sets King Cobras apart from their true Cobra relatives. In Africa, hunting is the last thing on Fern's mind. She's carefully chosen a nest site and laid her eggs. Her parenting duties are now over, and she won't be back. The nest is at great risk from predators like the Mozambique spitting cobra. If found, it would make for an easy, nutritious meal. But it's what lies just beyond the borders of Fern's territory that has caught this Mozambique spitting cobra's attention. Lush gardens provide the perfect habitat for the sniper who's looking for new turf. Getting in isn't easy. The local residents aren't too welcoming. The snipers come for a big prize, and adapting to a new habitat is a small price to pay in exchange. But who said anything worth winning ever came easy? The sniper's going to have to try another strategy. Perhaps the night beat would be more profitable. For the Mozambique spitting cobra, settling in the suburbs and switching to the nighttime beat is working out well. In the pitch dark, his excellent night vision isn't the only sense he's using to hunt with. Combining his ability to taste the air with his sense of smell, he can pinpoint the exact position of his target. The toad smells danger, but which way to turn? He makes the wrong choice. Fern chose her nest site well. For almost 2 months, it's gone unnoticed by predators. But it's late in the season. The newly hatched snakelings may struggle to find small enough prey like young frogs and toads. An army of tiny soldiers armed with chemical weapons. They disperse into the forest. natural-born killers on the loose. Petal's senses are firing up. She's 30 minutes old, and she's hungry. To eat, she must hunt. In true forest cobra style, she heads for water. Genetically programmed to look for amphibious prey. While she's inherited her mother's killer instincts and got the right tools, she's still got to learn how to use them. It's been a week since she hatched, and Petal's yet to launch a successful attack. Although she was born with a large yolk sac in her stomach, it will only provide her with nourishment for up to 2 weeks. She can't give up. He's almost three times her size. But her first bite is enough to inject paralyzing venom. Petal's perseverance pays off. In time, she will learn to eat her dinner with more finesse. But for now, she's proved she can survive in the fast lane of cobra life. The Cobra Mafia members aren't just masters of mayhem. They face lives filled with enemies competing for territory, mates, and prey. Whether true cobras or distant relatives claiming the name, they're all true survivors. Just earned a bad reputation. Africa's hot jungles are home to high-ranking mob members, the forest cobras. Meet Romeo, Don of Africa's forests and waterways, one of the biggest, meanest badasses around. His species' territory stretches throughout the African rainforests, making him one of the largest true cobras with such impressive real estate in the world. And big guys play with big guns. Romeo's bringing his to the heat of this battle. When it comes to the ladies, he means business. But the prize he's fighting for might not hang around long enough to be won. Fern is a female forest cobra. She's hanging back in the shadows, interested enough, but not convinced of either male's prowess. yet. They'll have to prove their mettle to win her admiration, and possibly a chance to mate with her. Is either guy Cobra enough to convince her he's the one? In Asia, Fern's cousin, the King Cobra, is also working the dating department. And she set her sights pretty high. She's after the Godfather. As far as potential mates go, he'd be the catch of the century. He's got the whole package. His species title as king comes with a vast territory that spans the forested regions in India across into Southeast Asia, an area almost the size of North America. Growing to over 17 feet in length, he's the world's longest venomous snake. Elongated muscles and tendons stabilize his ribs and lower body, allowing him to extend upwards. When he pulls this classic cobra-style move, he can look a grown man of 6 feet in the eye. They rule the reptilian underworld through fear. Hooded assassins, armed with sophisticated weapons and specialist skills. Over 270 species of these elite snakes belong to the Elapidae family. Their reign of terror spans two continents, where their name alone evokes widespread panic. For included in their ranks are the world's greatest venomous snakes. They are the Cobra Mafia. A newly hatched forest cobra draws her first breath and rests for a moment. Petal might be at her most vulnerable right now, but she's a little hunter in the making, and will soon see just what she's capable of. For she belongs to a veteran gang of predators who rule the reptilian streets of Africa and Asia. The Cobra Mafia is a group of ruthless hitmen, each equipped with a set of skills to run their operations. Unlike most other groups of snake species, they're armed with hollow fangs designed like hypodermic needles, used to inject deadly venom into their victims. But it's their trademark move and iconic shape that distinguishes them from most other serpents. Raising a third of their body length off the ground, they use specially adapted muscles to expand modified ribs. And stretching their neck skin, they form hoods, striking the defense pose that has terrified their enemies for centuries. But there are imposters within their ranks. Cousins who have mastered the move, even employ the hooding. And their behavior behind closed doors doesn't comply with the strict Cobra code of conduct. Is this a family of cold-blooded killers? Or have they... A creature sometimes revered, but mostly feared. Born fully independent, instinct is already driving her. A powerful array of finely tuned senses is firing up. Her mission is to survive. And to survive, she must kill. She's on her own, and dangers abound. She may be the only one of 13 siblings to survive. But she's a natural-born killer. Equipped with an inherited arsenal of deadly weapons and characteristic Cobra bad attitude. Her presence stirs fear as her family name and reputation precedes her. For good reason.